Now, with all the stories making the headlines this Friday lunchtime, it's the ITV News.
Over to Sue Gray. The Prime Minister says it's up to her whether to name and shame anyone involved in Partygate. We understand she wants to identify the senior civil servants involved in the rule-breaking gatherings.
That will be entirely up to Sue Gray, and I've been looking forward very much to seeing what she has to say, and fingers crossed that will be pretty soon next week.
Also this lunchtime, police investigate the trouble on the pitch when Crystal Palace's manager appears to lose his cool with a fan. 11 new cases of monkeypox are confirmed in the UK. I'll be joined by our resident GP, Dr. Sarah Jarvis, who will talk us through the outbreak. Jamie Oliver takes his obesity protest to number 10 and... First Eurovision, now the charts. Could Spaceman rocket to the top of the pops?
This is the ITV Lunchtime News with Romily Weeks.
Good afternoon. It's been a long wait, but now with the police investigation over, the Sue Gray report into Downing Street parties will finally see the light of day. ITV News understands that senior civil servants have been warned. She intends to identify them in the report, which will be published next week. Her interim findings were strongly critical of failures of leadership inside Number 10. The Prime Minister at the Conservative conference in Wales has said the issue of naming names is up to Sue Gray. Our political reporter Shihab Khan has this report.
After a stressful period, today was sweet relief for the Prime Minister. He was at a honey producer in Wales this morning in the knowledge that the police investigation into Partygate is over and he's only been fined once. Sue Gray's report is now next on the agenda as speculation mounts over whether she will name others who got fixed penalty notices.
That will be entirely up to Sue Gray, and I'll be looking forward very much to seeing what she has to say, and fingers crossed that will be pretty soon next week.
We are expecting her full report next week, and she has written to senior civil servants warning them of her plans to identify them. Fran Hall, who helps to maintain the COVID memorial wall, says they should all resign.
We followed the rules. You know, I'm here with a whole load of bereaved people who've all lost somebody to COVID, and we followed the rules. We didn't go to the hospital. Some people weren't able to go to funerals. We followed the rules to protect other people, and they didn't. And it's outrageous.
While Fran's position is clear, in Whitehaven, Cumbria, opinions were split.
Never bothered me from the beginning, to be honest.
Not really that bothered about it now.
People dying all over, and these lots here, making the rules and breaking the rules, you know. Sitting partying and laughing at people.
For me, it's sort of things have moved on.
Labour are in their own trouble. Their leader, Keir Starmer, is under investigation over whether he broke lockdown rules himself during a visit last year. His party are adamant that it's totally different.
There's no comparison between repeated parties that seem to have been taking place at number 10, with now Downing Street being the most fined location in the whole of the UK. And Keir Starmer's approach, which has been to say, if he's fined, he said he will immediately stand down. What a contrast with the approach of the Prime Minister.
While the police investigation may have come to a close, for those who have lost friends and family members, this will be a story they struggle to forget.
Shihab, there's quite a controversy about Sue Gray's report even before we get it.
Yeah, that it at the moment hinges on this idea that Sue Gray has written to senior civil servants to let them know that she is going to be identifying them. And there's been some controversy within government departments for a number of reasons. Firstly, many of these civil servants thought they would remain unnamed. There's also controversy over the fact that there are some junior members of staff within government who have been fined for events that they feel as though that senior members haven't been fined for. And there's a lot of discussion over that. The Sue Gray report in particular, there were suggestions that Downing Street was potentially trying to put pressure on Sue Gray to not published those names. They have vehemently denied that. I've spoken to a number of people, number 10, who say that's just categorically not true. The Prime Minister was asked about it himself. He also said it wasn't true. I spoke to the Deputy Prime Minister. He also said it wasn't true. What we do know is that we've had this interim report already from Sue Gray. We know it's quite damning. We know it's critical. As you mentioned, Romily, that she said that there was a failure of leadership in number 10. Now, sources that I've spoken to in government say they want this to be the final moment of this. This is the last part of the investigation. And once it is published, they want to draw a line under this and move on.
Shehab, thanks for that update. Merseyside police have launched an investigation after an altercation on the pitch at the Everton-Crystal Palace game last night. Crystal Palace manager Patrick Vieira appeared to kick a fan who was taunting him after his side's defeat. Footage shows Vieira confronted by a fan who appears to repeatedly gesture in his face as he makes his way across the pitch to the away side's dressing room. Vieira responds by first grabbing the man and then swinging a kick at him before other supporters usher him away. Well, to Martin Stew, who's at Crystal Palace's home ground, Selhurst Park. Martin.
Well, look, for a bit of background here, what had happened is Everton had gone 2-0 down and then came on to win 3-2, a massive result for the fans. They flooded the pitch in jubilation because they knew they'd avoided those Everton players coming up with a phone in their hand, appearing to goad the Crystal Palace manager, who then, as you say, appears to lash out, looking like he's either trying to kick or trip one of the fans to the ground. Now, there is another video which was filmed, we think, by the man who was tackled. We're not going to show it to you because the language is way too fruity, but it does show that there was a fair bit of intimidation. And undoubtedly, the fans here at Palace say, well, it was fair for Patrick Vieira to react in the way he did. It was only human. Although critics of his say, well, hang on a minute, he is the manager of a Premier League football team. He should be setting an example and shouldn't have acted in that way.
So what happens now, Martin?
Well, two things. There's two investigations going on, one by the FA, the Football Association, the other by the Merseyside Police. But this plays into a much wider background of pitch invasions and problems. Last night at the same time, we saw another pitch invasion at Port Vale. There it appears that Port Vale fans attacked Swindon players, the Swindon manager saying they were physically and verbally abused. And that's just a day after Nottingham really brutal attacks. Football has to get this under control. Steward companies tell me they can't get enough staff. Stopping pitch invasion is really difficult, but we don't want to go back to the bad days of the 70s and 80s. We want people to be focusing on the football, not violence amongst the
Martin
fans.
Martin at Selhurst Park, thank you. The Ukrainian President Zelensky has thanked the US after its Senate approved a landmark $40 billion aid package to the country. In his nightly address, President Zelensky said the aid package was a manifestation of strong leadership and a necessary contribution to our common defense of freedom. The military, economic and food aid package was backed by all Democrats and most Republicans, making it America's biggest commitment yet to help Ukraine. The number of monkeypox cases in the UK have more than doubled. Another 11 cases were confirmed today by the Health Security Agency. Most of the cases are mild and the government has bought more doses of vaccines against the virus. Monkeypox is usually very rare and it's mainly spread by wild animals in parts of West or Central Africa. It can be passed on by close contact with another infected person. There are a total of 20 confirmed cases in the UK so far. Elsewhere, Spain has confirmed 21 cases. In Portugal, there are 14. Belgium has 2 cases. Well, our regular lunchtime news GP, Dr. Sarah Jarvis, is with us now to go through all of this. Sarah, many people won't have heard of monkeypox before this. Why are we seeing this explosion of cases?
We don't actually know. There are usually about 3,000 cases a year in West Africa, mostly in Nigeria. But a lot of that is people who eat bush meat. Now, it's called monkeypox because that's where it was first identified in monkeys. But actually, it's mostly harbored by rats. And there's one called the Gambian pouched rat, which was responsible for an outbreak in the USA in 2003. But it's not usually very easy to pass on. And we've very rarely seen cases where it's been passed on between humans. happens. It's not like COVID. It's not really easy to catch. It's spread by large droplets. Someone would have to sort of cough or sneeze in your face, or otherwise by touching those spots, which start off like blisters, then become pus-filled spots, and then gradually scab over. Or possibly you may be able to catch it by touching bedding or clothing that somebody who's got those spots is wearing or has used.
So not too easy to catch, that's good news. But should people be considering getting vaccinated against it?
Well, we haven't got enough vaccine at the moment. Of course, the great news is that we did manage to eradicate smallpox, which had a very, very high mortality rate. And the vast majority of people here do get better. So the UK Health Security Agency has said we have got a vaccine. That's great news. The smallpox vaccine is probably 85% effective. And there is one vaccine which is licensed in the USA from 2019. So it was licensed about 3 years ago for both smallpox and monkeypox. The trouble is we don't know who the highest risk people are. And there may be a lot of them. Because, for instance, in one group of four who were identified earlier this week, they all self-identified as gay, men who have sex with men, or bisexual. Now, that doesn't mean that this is a sexually transmitted disease. It may well be that it's because of close bodily contact, skin to skin contact. So if you're in a household, if you think you might have it, and we're talking there about fever, headaches, muscle aches, but particularly the specific symptoms, the swollen lymph glands, feeling hot and cold all over, a rash which may start in your face, possibly around your mouth, and then spread to the rest of your body, particularly your genitals, and starts with sort of blisters which turn pus-filled. If you think you have that, please ring NHS 111 or ring a local sexual health clinic so they can get you checked out safely.
And it sounds like there's lots that we don't know about this. Is there any idea why it seems that the UK and Portugal and Spain are seeing higher numbers?
No, unfortunately, I wish we did know. Interestingly, the USA identified, Canada identified its first case as somebody who had come over from the UK. Whether or not there's been a small group of people, the first case was somebody who had travelled from Nigeria. Most of the other cases, we don't know about today's cases, but most of the other nine were in people who hadn't travelled. So it may just be that there's a small group of people. There is an incubation period of about 10 days between being exposed and getting it. So perhaps somebody had a party or a few parties, and then it's been passed on by that. But you would need to have quite close bodily contact or prolonged contact to catch it.
And clearly, people are going to be worried hearing about another virus outbreak. But is the overall advice not to panic?
Yes, absolutely. It is certainly not to panic. Most people are not going to be at high risk. If you don't come into regular close contact with lots of other people, probably close skin to skin contact, then you're unlikely to be at high risk. But particularly if you have recently had close skin to skin contact with somebody else, particularly perhaps if you're a man who identifies as gay or a man who has sex with men, then you would want just to be aware, particularly of that rash, particularly if it's around your face and spreads to other parts of your body, including your genitals, and to seek medical help.
Dr. Sarah Jarvis, thanks for setting that out so clearly for us. And we have much more on the monkeypox outbreak on our website. Head to itv.com/news. Still to come, the Queen's Platinum Jubilee cities, the town's celebrating a new honour, and Sam's race to number one. Celebrity chef Jamie Oliver has been leading a protest outside Downing Street today because the government has delayed some of its plans to tackle obesity. There's a pause on plans to buy one, get one free deals for unhealthy food products like biscuits and breakfast cereals, which were due to come later this year due to the unprecedented squeeze on living standards. A ban on TV adverts for products high in fat, salt or sugar before the 9 p.m. watershed, and online adverts is also being delayed by 12 months. While I'm joined by our reporter, Charlie Frost. Charlie, there was quite a turnout at Downing Street earlier today.
Oh, yes, that's right. Jamie Oliver turned up almost on the Prime Minister's doorstep, holding, well, pretty big eaten mess, and he was joined by protesters holding banners saying, "Boris, don't put politics before our children's health." calling his delay on bringing in measures to try to curb childhood obesity, well, an eaten mess, because it was Boris Johnson's government that has come up with these policies, getting rid of buy one, get one free promotions on junk food and adverts promoting foods that are high in salt, sugar or fat before the 9 p.m. watershed. And now they're the ones pressing pause on it. Well, this is what Jamie Oliver had to say earlier.
So I'm most angry about the consistent lack of attention placed on child health. If you look back at the handful of last elections, when has child health ever been fundamental? If you look at Britain right now, going it alone in Europe, you know, it's so important just as a business to be knocking out healthy, productive young people. At the moment, if you look at the graph, it was already bad, but since COVID, child health has really got worse. This is the worst time for Boris to do a U-turn. This is his own strategy.
Well, protesters, they agreed with Jamie Oliver too, and they feel that the longer we wait to bring in these policies and these restrictions, the more detrimental it will be to children's health.
And the Prime Minister was asked about it too?
Yes, the Prime Minister was asked about it too. He is on a visit to Wales today and he said that the government does still want to improve the health of the nation, but it wants to do it when the health of the nation's finances has improved too.
We understand the vital importance of tackling obesity. It costs the NHS huge sums of money. And at this particular time, if people can save on their food bills with some offers, then I think we've just got to be flexible whilst continuing to tackle obesity.
Well, other measures are still going ahead, including restrictions on where some foods are placed in supermarkets. That's still happening in October.
And Charlie, give us an idea of what people were saying about this too.
Well, they were very much agreeing with Jamie Oliver. They too feel that the longer we wait to bring in these restrictions on the buy one, get one free and the adverts, that that will be detrimental to our children's health. And these are some of the protesters that were at the protest earlier.
I'm very disgusted with this current government for doing a U-turn after seeing these young people put in so much work. The turnout today is remarkable.
It's not only these adults and Jamie Oliver that care about this issue, it's us ourselves that are constantly bombarded by the junk food ads, and we want to protect not only ourselves but the future generation, even people younger than myself.
Kids care as well about the issue. It's not just Jamie and it's not just all of the adults and parents here who care about the issue, but we do care for our health and we care for all of our friends and our peers.
Well, yes, as I say, this is just a pause according to the government, and these measures will be brought in 12 months' time.
We'll see what happens. Thank you very much for that. The Queen has awarded a record number of places city status as part of her Platinum Jubilee celebrations. 8 towns across the UK and Port Stanley on the Falkland Islands will now be cities. And our North of England reporter Hannah Miller is in Doncaster, one of them. Hannah, how does Doncaster and all the other cities feel about their new status?
Well, it really is the talk of the town here, Romley, or should I say the talk of the city. There is no one we've spoken to this morning who hasn't heard that this is happening. Here in Doncaster, they've been trying to become a city for more than 10 years, and it is now finally happening, along with Colchester, Milton Keynes, Wrexham, Dunfermline, Bangor in Northern Ireland and Port Douglas on the Isle of Man. All because we're told of the pride that people feel in their communities, their local history and their links to the royal family. Here that means the St. Ledger horse race that takes place every year and the industrial heritage, particularly Doncaster being famous for having built the Flying Scotsman and the Mallard trains. And it's fair to say that this morning here in the market there is plenty of pride that this puts Doncaster on the map.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah, fantastic for the town, city. Yeah, great stuff.
Doncaster people are great, friendly people, and we all have, especially on this market, a lot to offer.
Well, new football stadium, great race course, college, beautiful church, you know.
Have a good look round. We, in every corner of Doncaster there's something to see, so you're not going to have a boring day out in Doncaster.
And one surprise new city on the Falkland Islands.
Yes, absolutely. And the question that everyone then is asking is, will this really make any difference to all of these places? The idea is that they will find it easier to get funding from the government. It will provide a real boost to local communities and they'll be able to attract international investment. The Falkland Islands as well on that map today.
Hannah, thank you for that. And finally, a relative newcomer to the world of pop will try and topple a veteran from top spot of the charts today. Yes, it's Sam Ryder, who's hoping his Eurovision hit will be number one tonight. His competition, Harry Styles. Here's Sangeeta Kandola.
He may have been runner-up at Eurovision, but he has been rocketing up the UK singles chart. Sam Ryder has been on a mission all week in his race to get his space man to the top spot.
So get going. Let's do this. I fully believe and have full faith that we will achieve this. You know it's not the
same as it was. Standing in Sam's direction is Harry Styles, who's been sitting at the number one summit for 6 weeks already. But Sam isn't afraid of the competition. He took on 24 other countries at Eurovision in Turin last weekend, coming second overall and scoring the highest points ever achieved by the UK. Not bad for a lad from Essex who took to TikTok, sharing his music during the first lockdown, totting up 12 million followers and counting, and catching the attention of Alicia Keys and Elton John before signing a major record deal. There have only been 5 UK Eurovision entries that have topped the charts here. The last time was 1996 with Gina G's Ooh Ah Just a Little Bit. Before that, it was Bucks Fizz with Making Your Mind Up in 1981. So the battle for the big one is on, but judging by the beaming smile on Sam's face, whether Spaceman tops the charts or not tonight, he looks like he's having a blast. Sangeeta Kandola, ITV News.
We're going to be singing that all afternoon. That is it this lunchtime, but Charlene's here with the evening news at 6:30. The news where you are follows the national weather from everyone here. Goodbye.